See, Mr. Knox, why don't we start with you? And let me get just some real basic information about you. When you were born and what your full name is, and something about your family background, the brothers and sisters that you had. When were you born?
1892.
Do you remember the day and month?
February 27th.
Uh-huh. Were you born in Kansas City or?
In Kentucky.
In Kentucky.
Owensboro, Kentucky.
Was it Owensburg?
Owensboro.
Mm-hmm. Did you have a large family?
No, I just had one girl. Mm-hmm.
Did you go to school there in Kentucky?
Yes, I went to school in Kentucky.
How far did you get there in your schooling? Did you go on to high school there or?
1 year of high school.
Mm-hmm. Did you do have any occupations at all before you went into the service?
Yes. You mean in Kansas City?
Okay. When did you move from Kentucky?
I came to Kansas City in 1907.
1907. And what did you do when you came to Kansas City? What type of job did you have?
Chauffeur.
Chauffeur? Did you join the reserves prior to entering the service on active duty in World War I? Were you a member of the state reserves?
No. It was a bunch of us went first and enlisted as armored drivers.
What were do you remember the circumstances when war was declared? Remember back in April of 1917, the United States declared war on Germany.
Yeah.
Do you remember what did you do on that day that war was declared?
I called me to enlist.
You decided that was.
I was reading in the papers about a draft of a soldier,
mm-hmm.
and how the rats and the paint and such running up and down the trenches, fighting the wounded soldiers and everything. So I just heard about this ambulance deal, and so I said, well, you'll have to come in with this ambulance to get me. So I enlisted as ambulance driver. I wasn't drafted.
Do you remember your date of enlistment?
Not exactly.
Was it before America declared war on Germany?
No.
Or was it afterwards?
Exactly.
Afterwards. And so did you join the Army here in Kansas City, or did you have to do that at Camp Funston?
Camp Funston.
What are some of the memories that you have of your first days in the Army when you were there at Camp Funston? What did they do to you when you first you took your oath, and then what happened?
Well, we had regular duties, exercises, drilling, and hiking, and so on, and for pleasure tonight, we either got to go to Junction City or Army City and play pool and did other things, pass away the time.
How long were you there at Camp Funston before you left?
If I remember, I imagine we had people there 3 months or more. What are you about?
Did both of you gentlemen sail on the same ship?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, that's interesting.
And we went in the Funston together.
Now, were you in the 317th Sanitary Train?
Yeah.
317th Sanitary Train. And what company were you in?
Ambulance Company 366.
And, okay, and that's...
It was 365, 366, 367, and 368.
Mm-hmm.
7 and 8 were mule drawn. 65 and 66 were...
And did you train with ambulances there at Camp Funston, or did you learn medical things about medical?
We trained not on ambulances, but the trucks. We had trucks that we trained mm-hmm. in Funston.
So then you sailed on April 17th, was it?
I can't remember.
But that would have been, was that 1918?
No.
1918. So, Were you pretty excited about getting on the ship and going over to France?
Yes, I was very excited. On one job that I had, my folks went abroad, and they told me some really great things about abroad, and I was always anxious to go. So that's another reason I enlisted, was the chance to get to abroad.
Mm-hmm.
So I was tickled to death. I was so afraid I wouldn't pass my examination so I could get to go.
So you had, it was a feeling of an adventure then for you.
Oh yes, all the way.
What, where did the ship dock when you landed in France?
In Brest.
In Brest, did you go to a particular camp at that time?
Yeah, in Brest, they kept us there for a while, then they sent us to the front.
Mm-hmm.
To the hospital place.
Did you go to a training area behind the lines before you entered?
No, we didn't have anything. We went over there and we weren't there any time before we relieved the French elements.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we rode around with the French drivers to learn the routes and from different hospitals. And then the French, we relieved them.
When your company, did you operate always together, all the trucks in your company operated as a company? Or were you sometimes split up when you were serving with the French there?
Well, we weren't split up.
Were the other companies all together with you,
yeah,
too?
All together.
So the sanitary train remained intact?
65, Ammons Company 65, and 66 did most of it because they were, or had automobiles, you know, mm-hmm. to haul the patients. The new John, they were the ones that were used to go into the actual combat, you mm-hmm. know, and pick up the
Did they ever replace those mule-drawn ambulances with motorized ambulances that you recall?
No, not as I recall.
What were some of your first impressions of France when you got over there? When you got off the boat, what were you thinking when you got off there?
Well, I didn't think much of it because we stayed a few days after dock before they took us to the actual duty. And the airport, I didn't like sleeping on bags and so forth, and you have mm-hmm. bed sleeping. It was really tough down there.
Did you probably had heard about the cooties and so forth there before? Yeah. Did they ever attack the company there?
No, not till we got into actual duty.
But then almost all the soldiers had cooties?
Oh, yes. I am on my ambulance, you know, I ate in my ambulance, slept in it, did everything as I told you. You have to get in the ambulance to get me. And I accumulated the cooties from my blankets for hauling wounded soldiers.
I'd always heard, you know, there was a popular pastime among World War I soldiers that they called reading their shirt, is what they called, looking for cooties.
That's right. Take a candle and light it, you know, and just go around the collar with that candle, and you could hear them pop, 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 pop.
Oh, my word. you remember some of the, your first impressions of France weren't too good. I always heard France called sunny France. Was it, what was the weather like over there?
Well, some parts of France, it really had bad weather, a little cold, good, the rain.
Mm-hmm.
Down at a place called Aix-les-Bains where we got when we go on relief,
mm-hmm.
was something like our Excelsior Springs. And it was very nice
mm-hmm.
there.
Mm-hmm. The when you went into the lines there, how long were you actually in the front? If you arrived there in April 1918, were you involved in the Meuse-Argonne battle?
Oh yeah. Our base hospital was in Toul, France.
In Toul.
Yeah. And we were evacuated from Metz to Pont-à-Mousson.
Mm-hmm.
And we were just about to go into Metz when the armistice was signed.
Do you, what were some of your impressions of Toul? I think there was a large air base there, wasn't there? One of the American Aero Squadrons?
And an ammunition dump there, too.
Do you remember seeing those early airplanes flying?
Oh, my. They were so common that we wouldn't look up. Battles all over it. Battles, and it was so common we wouldn't even look up at it.
The wounded soldiers that you were carrying, were they mostly men from the 92nd Division?
Yes. And most of them were, 97. Two or three times I picked up a wounded German soldier.
Did you ever evacuate wounded Frenchmen?
Yes, I evacuated Frenchmen.
But
I was on my tour from the hospital. I had no trouble getting rid of them.
Imagine. Do you remember the Battle of the Semihil? That was the first action that American troops were involved in as a unit.
I think we hadn't arrived.
Okay. But you do recall the Meuse-Argonne battle. Mm-hmm. What were some of the cities there that you remember visiting in the battle when you drove your ambulances up to the front?
Well, let's see. I think Pontiacon,
Did you go to, were you at, going up to the advanced dressing stations with your ambulances, or were you evacuating them from dressing stations further to the rear?
No, we go to the front and we see, and then bring them to the base hospital, and then according to his wound, if he was able to go back, he'd leave it there. If he wasn't, we'd bring him on to Nancy, and they'd send him back and back. Finally, he'd end up in the States again. He was part of his wound, and how bad it was.
Well, on the armistice, the day the armistice was signed, on November 11th, 1918, do you remember where you were at that time and what your feelings were?
Yeah.
Where was that?
I was between Pont-Mousson and Metz.
Were you in?
I was en route to pick up some wounded soldiers.
What happened on the armistice day?
Well, everything happened. The eighth French aviator in the war, he went up to celebrate on champagne and everything, and he had a head dive, and I don't think they ever found the motor.
My word. But did you notice
was just wild. They all had champagne and just pouring it all over everybody and just having a time.
Do you remember the sound? Did the sound of gunfire cease right at 11 o'clock? You know, we all often hear about how loud it must
have
been.
So much more than that. I didn't pay attention.
What happened after the armistice?
Well, all I was thinking about then was getting home.
How soon did you get home? How long did you have to wait in France?
Well, I can't say exactly how long, but it wasn't long because it was the Pioneer Infantry relieved us. Mm-hmm. They came over to do the dirty work and clean up France and all that. We weren't there long.
Did you stay there for Christmas? Were you in France during Christmas? Did you receive any packages from home?
Well, we got a lot of packages, but there was a lot of crookedness there. YMCA received packages, the soldiers and everything.
I've heard some complaints from other soldiers of World War One about the Red Cross or the YMCA. Was there a favorite of the two services?
There was a lot of prejudice over there. Even the latrines were, white over here, colored there. Drinking fountain, colored there, white over there. So you could tell how we felt.
Okay, as a black soldier, when you got off that ship in France, did you feel that you were treated differently than the other American soldiers by the French people?
Oh, no, the French people was not welcome, wide open arms, crazy guys.
What about...
The only trouble we had was American white.
That was my next question. What about your fellow soldiers, the white soldiers there?
We didn't come in contact. Just when they came to... The Rainbow Division out of Texas came over and relieved us.
But do you remember any incidences of problems between the American units there?
Well, I can tell you of one.
This is interesting to me because, of course, I was not born then, and you know, all I can ever learn about this is just from what I read in books and so forth, and to hear it from a man who was really there.
Fun. There was one incident. There was a colored soldier with an animal drawing outfit. He came up to the watering trough with his four horses to drink. A white soldier out of the Rainbow Division came up with four horses to drink. He says, "Pull over there, nigga, let my horses drink." He says, "I was here first." And this white soldier up with his gun like that, and this colored fellow shot his hand off.
Oh, my word.
He was just quick. Well, when you do something over there, they send you to the front. The officer in charge in the front sends you over the top that night. If you get back, you were justified. If you don't get back, you were convicted. They sent this colored soldier to the front. The officer in charge sent him over. Next morning he came back with 41 Germans marching in front of him, hauling comrades. Hmm. You see, that was because they were hungry. They took him to Paris and banqueted him, gave him the quarter again and everything, and I even had my tank shot off of my ambulance and didn't get doodly squat.
I think there were quite a few fellows over there that probably were heroes and didn't get recognized.
That's
for
what
that,
I'm talking about. Now, I was, you know, one soldier trained 6 months, go out and capture 41 soldiers, been trained for 3 years, the best of training, and march 41 of them in front of near Holland comrade. And they take him to Paris, banquet him, give him a crawdy gear and all that stuff. I'm out there scuffling in mud, going through Death Valley, signs on the tree say, "Step on it, Death Valley." And my tank shot off of my ambulance, and you don't hear nothing about it.
On another subject, do you remember the French, in the French Army, there were a lot of Negro units. Did you see them and come in contact with those men?
And I was very glad to see them, because most of them are all officers, and they were fine-looking guys.
So you had high respect then for the French units.
And the white American soldier wouldn't respect them. They wouldn't even salute them, and that's why it caused a lot of trouble.
What did it be your overall impression then of the French people then? Were they friendly to you?
Oh yes, the French people. It's fine. I had a quartet over there, and we'd go around and entertain at night. And the French girls would holler, "Oh, jelly neck and soldier, all come saw boo boo."
did they call you the Buffalo Soldiers while you were overseas?
No, they didn't call us.
Did you have a nickname?
American Soldier. That's all I can remember.
Among yourselves, did you refer to yourselves with a nickname at all?
No. I don't remember. So I didn't do much socializing. You know, I was always in Miami.
Were you much of a souvenir hunter?
Oh, yes. I had quite a few souvenirs. Just like I told you, I picked up a French officer once. I had his helmet and his Luger. And, of course, he died on my ambulance, and I discharged him at the hospital when I got to the hospital. And I had quite a few souvenirs. And when I go to the lousing place, D.D. Lowes, to enter the ship to come home, I go in one door, leaving my souvenirs, and come out the back door, all new clothes and everything. I don't know what happened to my souvenirs.
He lost everything.
Lost everything. I just like other soldiers.
When you got on that ship, how long did it take you to on your return voyage?
We went over in 7 and came back in 6. 6 days.
6 days. What was the name of the ship? Do you remember?
But I'll tell you.
Went along the Great North, two sister ships.
Yeah.
We came back on the second largest ship afloat,
92 feet wide. That was a lift.
Do you remember the reception you got when you got home? Were there a lot of people on the docks waiting for you and cheering?
No. Was it? Landed in Upton, New York, and I didn't see my phone.
There was no one there waiting for you. Okay, when you got off
the... As far as Fifth Avenue Parade, I never heard of nothing like that.
What happened then when you got off the boat? Did they put you on
the train?
We went
there, but about a week, and then they shipped us to the Kentucky Church. It was the Churchill Downs, you know, where the racetrack was. That was a soldier camp there. That's where I was mustered out.
Okay, and then did you take the train back to Kansas City?
Going to Kansas.
Were you wearing your uniform at that time?
Oh, yeah.
What was it? What was the red stripe that you had on there?
This
discharge chevron, they didn't issue those to you at all.
Quite.
When you got home, what was the reaction of the people here in Kansas City as you arrived with your uniform? Did they thank you for what you had done? That you remember? Well, surely your family was there to welcome you home.
Yeah, our friends. You know, glad to see us home. And I went back on my job that I left when I came back.
Did you join any veterans organizations?
Yes.
When you returned? What did you join?
American Legion.
Were you active in the American Legion?
No, in those days. Just a member.
I think we forgot to ask your rank also, or rating.
I was a Corporal.
When you were mustered out?
Yes.
And
I was, just before the armistice signed, I was in charge of 41 Avenue. At rank of corporal. And I had taken an examination, and I had passed, and before I got my sergeant stripes, armistice
works.
So I never received it. Uh-huh. But I did the work of a sergeant as rank of corporal.
Mm-hmm. And what did you do briefly since the war? What did you do?
Well, I came back to my job, and I worked on my job. And it was a couple, a very wealthy man in Independence, Kansas, married an old lady out in Illinois. He was 79. And she was 72. And for a bridal present, he gave her a $10,000 Pearsall car. They called the Pearsall people and told them they wanted a chauffeur for this couple. The couple wanted to do a lot of traveling and touring in this fine car. Myself being a single man, the most boys that they interviewed for the job were married and didn't want to leave home.
Mm-hmm.
So the Pearsall people called me and said, "Bill, we got a job. It's for a single man. You single. This gentleman just bought a $10,000 car for his wife. They're going to do a lot of touring, traveling, and they need a single man." I quit my job. I'd been on 10 years to take this job. We went east every summer, 5,000-6,000 miles.
This would be in the 1920s?
Yeah. And I worked for that couple 15 years till they both died.
To what year was that?
I can say from 1923 up to 15 years on. Kind of.
30 years.
And I went to work after they both died. I went to work for C.W. Jenkins. I stayed with them till they both died.
Mm-hmm. When was that about? In the 1940s, yet?
Yeah. And they were living at the Wongs at that time. And when they both died, the Wongs gave me a job. Mr. Bruce Dodson, a very wealthy insurance man, had his own private railroad car. he called me up one morning. He knew me. I used to caddy for his daddy when his daddy was living. He said, "Bill, do you ever railroad?" I said, "No." Every time I don't wish him, I just get in my car and go. I mean, he says, "Well, I believe you just what I want." Says, "I hire these boys that work for the Santa Fe and Union Pacific and the Rock Island. I can't tell them a damn thing." Says, "You have no experience. I believe I could teach you to be just what I want." So he hired me, and I had charge of this private railroad car. We would leave Kansas City in October, and wouldn't come in October, and wouldn't come home till April. We'd go to Miami. It opened up the tropical, and closed with Gulf Street. He lived on his yacht on the beach. I kept the private car over in Miami to turn. And we would go to Miami. We would stop at New Orleans. And there would be a crew to greet him when he arrived. His crew would clean this private car and make it look just like new. So one trip down, it was one of those old cold, rainy days. This reading crew wasn't out to greet us. He says, "Where is everybody?" I said, "I don't know." He said, "Maybe we should get the car fixed up in Jacksonville and place up New Orleans. I'll do better than that. I'll sell the damn thing." So when we get to Miami, showing up the fruit buyer down there, bought the private car. Mm-hmm. I've been working for Mr. Dodson 4 years.
Do you know what year that was about when he sold it?
I don't remember.
Was it in the 1940s yet or
something like that? Mm-hmm. And sold his private car and bought a jet for 2 experienced pilots. Now, all I'd have had to do was valet like it, take care of him, ride all over the country in this jet, the same as I did on the private car. But I'd never been up. So I gave the job to my cook on the private car. And so Mr. Dodd said, "Well, Bill, why not go down to the office and work?" "Well, I'm making $400 a month on the private car. Mm-hmm. If I go down to the office and work, I get $250. So I said, "No, Mr. Dodson, I believe I'll retire and take my Social Security at this $100 wage."
Mm-hmm.
So he said, "Well, you got something there, Bill." So I retired. I've been retired over 20 years.
Mm.
So.
Mr. Knox, did you have anything else that you care to add?
No.
Any more thoughts? Well, I really...
All that Mr. Swinney says is my sentence.
I really appreciate you taking the time out to share all your sentiments with us. And I hit this rewind. I got too nervous.
You want the same one?
Sure. Anything you feel like playing. This is Bill Knox playing his ukulele. And it's July.
Thank you.
at Don Mills take you up the Lazy River, okay. And Bill Knox will bring you back. Up the Lazy River, up the Lazy River. Blue skies above, every mountain low, up the lazy river, come swim along with me. Up the lazy river, how happy we will be. Up the lazy river with me. Up the lazy river, yeah. Up the lazy river, 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 the lazy stuff in this. I don't believe they need to write the notes, but thank you.
He like this.
Yeah.
He's got fine ear, this man.
This is my blues.
Yeah, lay it down on.
Oh, tell me, if you don't like.